Hello, once again, you're very welcome to Alt Ireland Radio from Truthful Irish. My name is Larry, how are you? Hello to all the usual suspects out there. Anne-Marie Devereaux, how are you? How are you? Anna D'Alessandro, how are you doing? Bobby Toll, how are you? All looking forward to Christmas? It's very close now, we're 2 days out. Rob Halford, you nugget in Australia. Hello, how are you doing? Well, it's a bit chilly here this evening. I get a little bit of my voice back, as you probably notice. It's great. Not everyone I think it's great. Anyway, Tony Houlihan, we refer to him as Dr. Death here in Ireland. Speaking now, it used to be all about, you know, the older people were at risk. This was wrong, that was wrong, but now it's the young people. Right across the board, that's frightened the people. I honestly believe this is to do with good and evil, the devil and God. Once again, they're out to ruin Christmas. Who do that? Only someone with evil in their heart. And they've all the excuses under the sun why they're doing it. Still excuses, you know. So, Houlihan, Dr. Death, as I said, we call him here in Ireland, is responsible for a lot of scandals, not forgetting the cervical smear scandal, where people, ladies, died. Some are still dying. Here's the man who is pretending to care about the health of people.
It's not a surprise to us. We've seen this at various waves of the pandemic in the past, but we are now seeing a significant increase in the incidence in people between the ages of 16 and 34. It's the young, highly mobile population, and the rates in that age group and the positivity in those age groups are increasing quickly. We see an increase in the Dublin region as well.
No, we don't. We hear figures being driven across the media by very handsomely paid messengers. That's all we see. And I won't call it Dr. Houlihan. DD, you know what I mean?
This is in keeping with the patterns now that have been seen across many parts of Northern Europe, Norway, Denmark, the Netherlands, and the UK. So we're not surprised at that.
No, we're not surprised that you can throw down names, throw out figures, baffle them with bullshit. That's what you're doing again.
And our message now will be to these younger people that, in as much as possible, to really cut your social contacts. There's only 5 or 6 days left to Christmas. You'll be meeting up with loved ones, family, friends. Do as much as you possibly can now to try and cut your contacts. Limit the possibility of you picking up that disease.
Well, thankfully, young people won't be listening to you, or me, but especially you.
People will decide to use antigen tests. Now, they're not appropriate to be used if you've got symptoms. If you've got symptoms, the right thing to do is to self-isolate and get a PCR test.
So if you have a sneeze, a cold, or the flu in flu season, unclean, stay at home. Spend money to the government to get another test.
But if you are using an antigen test, follow the instructions properly. And remember that a negative test doesn't necessarily tell you that you do not have the disease.
If you're negative, you're still a danger. If you're positive, you're still a danger. Duh.
The value of an antigen test is that if you take it when you don't have symptoms and if it's positive, that's an indication that you should stay away from whatever activity you were planning to undertake. That's the same.
Stay away from whatever activity you were going to take. Thank you for such clear guidance, Baldy.
Safe way to use them and to interpret their use. Well, for all of us, this is a very big wave of Omicron that's now coming. There are a very large number of cases that we can see in other European countries. We expect that this is what's going to happen. We're concerned that the impact that this might have in terms of hospitalizations will put significant strain on the health service. So,
no, what puts significant strain on the health service, DD, is government cutbacks, which have been going on for 20 or 30 years. We have always had a strained health service. You are lying.
extent that people can, to try and cut their contacts, to really focus on having Christmas with their a small circle of loved ones, family, close friends, and
seek Isle.
Try and meet up with the same people over Christmas rather than different people over the course of the days of Christmas. These are all basic, sensible measures that we can each individually plan to take to try and minimise the risk of passing on this infection to other people if we have it ourselves, or picking it up from other people. It'll take a little bit more time for us to be certain about these things, and there's not sufficient data yet for us to conclude that it's less severe. And it is the case that even if it's less severe, less likely to create a risk of hospitalisation for each individual who picks it up, if many, many more people are picking up this infection, which is what we can see is happening, we can still find ourselves almost paradoxically in a situation where the risk of hospitalisation for an individual is lower, but the risk across the population is higher because many more people pick up the infection. But it's really important to remember, we still don't know that this is a disease that is less severe. So our assumption will be...
Yes, you do know it's less severe. And you're told so by another professor of lunacy who discovered said BS.
You have to be careful in case this is as serious as Delta. And as we know, the sheer volume of cases that we're going to see is going to create other problems for us, in the sense that we'd have large numbers of people at the same time with the infection, many people who work in essential services forced to be out of work. So it's really important that people who are in essential services, healthcare staff, people working in childcare and other essential social services, really limit their contact with other people, minimise the chance of them picking up this disease, so they can continue to participate in providing the essential services that people will need through the Christmas period.
Alternatively, you may catch the flu, your human immune system will build up resistance and antibodies to it, and you're going to be grand again.
Well, we can see already that there's been a significant change in the pattern of our disease. The portion of cases now attributable to Omicron represents more than half of the cases that are occurring here, and we see, as I've said already, a significant increase in the rate of infection in the 16 to 34. It's not confined only to those, but it's particularly marked in the 16 to 30. This is all consistent with Omicron, and we expect, as other countries have seen, that these rates will continue to increase and that we may see substantial increases in the disease over the remaining days of December and into January.
Now, there's the chief medical officer already pushing this rubbish into January. Remember that for later.
We'll do everything we can to try and maintain, if you like, a focus on that, and to track the path of that disease and to continue to update our advice based on that. But our assumption is we'll see this disease continue to rise into January.
Again, he said it. So there's the brainwashing. January.
The extent that we can, it's really important that we all try to cut our social contacts and take every measure that we can to limit transmission. So if you have symptoms, stay at home. We know that only about 1 in 2 people who are reporting symptoms in our weekly tracking surveys are actually following the advice to stay at home and self-isolate when they have symptoms. That's the most important basic measure you can take. And then all the other public health measures that we're familiar with, the wearing of a face mask, social distancing, avoiding crowds, these are all really important. And then it's really important, boosting and vaccination. So the vaccinations and the boosters still work really well in prevent.
So the vaccinations and the boosters still work really well. Doesn't seem to be the case, does it, in real life? Because you have to go and get more of them. Israel, they're down now to number 4 in the jabs. So 1, 2, 3 didn't work. Who's telling lies?
Your infection becoming a severe infection if you do pick up the infection. And we expect that will be the case with Omicron just as it is with Delta. But it's really important to come forward to get the booster, because it restores the benefit of the vaccine in helping to limit transmission or the risk of your disease being passed on to somebody else. And it's really understandable that people will feel that, because this has been such a long time and a second Christmas, as you say, in a row. And for some people in society, a particular challenge, because people have been out of work, for example, their employment has been challenged, or individuals have had to bear the brunt of restrictions. You know, younger people have particularly had to, many of the activities that they love and that they look forward to have been taken from them for long periods of time. But it's still important for us to give the basic advice. We are genuinely concerned about this wave of infection, the risk this transmission poses to the individuals who pick it up, but in particular the risk that it poses to people who are vulnerable, people who in particular are not boosted. So if you haven't had your booster, you really have to be careful about who you're interacting with over the course of this Christmas.
Advertisement break. He's now advertising the booster. But if you're homeless, suffering from anything other than COVID, you're screwed. The health service doesn't care about you. And now, January ahead, Michael Martin, our self-appointed chief of the government, is also pushing January.
Are the worst days of the pandemic ahead of us? Are we looking at a nightmare January, do you think?
I think we're looking at a very challenging January. One has to look at this in perspective, I think. Compared to last year, you know, if you had the same number of cases right now, we would be in total lockdown. I think the vaccines have been of enormous help in preventing hospitalisation, admission to ICU, severe illness. There's no question about that, and the evidence is very clear. So the fact that we have a very robust booster campaign now with a lot of momentum, I think will give us significant protection. And so I think we can get through this. It's many twists and turns in this, no guarantees, one cannot be certain, but I think the combination of the booster campaign with modification in our behaviour, with the restrictions that have been introduced, if you combine all of that, I would like to think that we would be in a better position compared to last year in the context of a new variant arriving on the scene.
A new variant arriving on the scene. They just love all of this. Politics is power, power for money, controlling the nation. The very people who voted in these people are being abused by them. In Ireland, abuse is common practice from the health services, the government. Nothing new there.
Do you think it's possible we get away without having more restrictions? I'm not talking about in the coming days, but I'm talking about, say, when we get into January. Is it possible we won't need more restrictions? Because I think most people are kind of assuming there will be more.
Well, I think I'm watching what we did during Delta, and there was a period during the Delta when we thought we were in a bit of difficulty, particularly as the numbers creeped up in ICU and hospitalisation, and we asked people to work from home, we asked people to reduce the level of socialisation, and we know from research that people did that themselves and significantly reduced the appointments they had, they cancelled appointments, and that did result.
Another lie, people did not cancel their appointments, it was forced on them.
In the stabilisation of the Delta figures, we were winning over Delta, along comes Omicron. So what that demonstrates is that if we could reduce socialization by 20 to 30%, that's the aim of public health officials, then we can manage this, combined with a high momentum booster campaign, which really is going very strongly now over the last week or so. Very high numbers again last evening, 75,000 recorded yesterday between boosters and third doses. So that's really moving.
Since people started getting injected with an experimental drug and now being boosted up to their eyeballs, how are we still living with restrictions? The positive news is I think people are starting to cop on and realise they've been conned from day one. Follow the money.
So I think if we go along the route we're going, I think we have a very good chance.
Okay. Schools, we're getting a lot of texts in from people saying, I left my kids home from school today, and I sort of questioned the decision not to close the schools last Friday. Do you understand those concerns?
I do. I mean, I can understand many people's concerns and commentary in relation to various aspects of this. We did discuss this with public health. They were clear that the numbers actually were stabilising in schools over the last week or so. But also, if you start now with the schools, what's the rationale for reopening if you think there's a problem? The advice we're receiving right now is that there's not a problem or evidence to suggest that we should. So we're keeping...
Because people will say, of course there's evidence, sure, there's loads of kids in my kid's school who have it and they're passing it on and so on. But,
yeah, I mean... And
look, the Taoiseach there, the Irish leader, self-appointed, is saying now that children are not the risk. A few seconds ago, you've heard the Irish head of the health board saying the children are the risk. They don't even talk to each other, obviously.
Has been, we know from the 5 to 11 year olds, particularly latter part of November through early December, numbers are going up very high. Now,
the public health have a perspective on that, and they've looked at the data, and they believe there was a very significant level of community transmission, particularly during the Halloween break. But let's look at the other side of this, that for children, for many, many children, school is critical. For the development of the child overall, children need to be in school. So our overall objective is to maintain routine for children and also maintain the atmosphere, the environment where they can develop the best in terms of all aspects of their health, mental health, socialization.
Yeah.
And so when I worry about the impact of COVID-19 on children...
Really, you worry about them, do you? You shameful excuse for a man. You have mandated children wearing masks. You're a disgrace.
Even children born at the beginning of the pandemic,
yeah,
their level of socialization in the first 2 years has been much less, actually, than children ordinarily would have. And I think our childcare services, our early developmental services, have to be really beefed up now in the next while,
okay,
to really deal with the impact of COVID on children. And school is a critical weapon for us to protect children and to enable them to develop with their friends in the best way.
Okay. We were talking to Liam Fanning, obviously an expert in this field, a little earlier on the programme, and he was making the point, he was saying, look, it isn't really conceivable that we, like, say, go into 2022 and into next winter, the winter after this one, with, you know, more lockdowns and so on. And he was saying, he was making the point that the numbers of people in ICUs who are unvaccinated, and he said, I think it's time, and he went no further than this, but he did say, I think it's time to have a discussion about mandatory vaccination.
Yeah, we shall have mandatory vaccination because... Mm-hmm. That is the way. Good, yeah. Put your arm up. Put your other arm up. Put your arm up. Put your other arm up.
Do we need to have that discussion?
I'm personally of the view that we stick with the voluntary system. It has worked in Ireland more than anywhere else in the world. At 94% now.
Yeah.
Fully
it's a hardcore 6% though.
And but what is that telling the world? I mean, you go across Europe, you're looking at 60% vaccinated.
Yeah, yeah. No, we've done brilliant.
No, but I mean, there's a message there, isn't there? Some of those countries are now talking about mandatory vaccination. There's no guarantee that will work, by the way, in itself. I mean, I was listening to one prime minister talking about fines of €600 every 3 months. And that's what a mandatory regime looks like. In my view is, I think we have to keep pushing the voluntary approach, which has achieved an enormous amount. I do get the point that the unvaccinated take up a disproportionate element of the health service.
Liar, liar, pants on fire.
In terms of the ICUs and in terms of getting severely ill, we have learned in terms of targeting the latter part of the vaccination program, the last 2 or 3%, that in some instances it really meant targeting particular groups where there would have been maybe a historic resistance to vaccination that had come from other countries and so forth, where that would have been present. On balance, I think we should keep going with the approach that we've adopted so far.
All good, isn't it? It's all good. They want you to get chemistry pumped into your veins that'll go to every organ in your body. The company who makes it are exempt from being sued or prosecuted in any way. They're not responsible for what happens to you. The government are not liable for any damage done to your body because this is an experiment. This is an experiment. This is an experiment. You do not have to partake in an experiment and risk your life. Why would you? Happy Christmas to all of our listeners, all of our followers. Have a great Christmas. Celebrate. Enjoy yourself. And don't be told what to do by people you don't know, you don't want to know. Happy Christmas. I'll talk to you before the new year. You've been listening to Truthful Irish. Alt Ireland Radio. This is Larry, standing in, of course, for Chris. Take care.